Hello friends, welcome to AKS. Today we will be dealing with a topic called electric mobility. This will be useful in GS3 topic, transport, and you will have a spillover in different parts of the syllabus. You can use this topic in essay, etc. So let us start the topic. Electric mobility is to say that using electric vehicles and replacing fossil fuels because they are disrupting our environment. The journey of fossil fuels to electric vehicles is all about the discussion. In this discussion, we will be dealing with fossil fuels that are petrol and diesel, pollution, greenhouse gas emissions, what are the impacts on life systems, how is polar ice melting happening in a rapid pace. We have conferences to discuss environmental matters and what is the solution. Is renewable energy the solution? We will be dealing in this discussion. So let us start with the basics. What is a fossil fuel? Fossil fuel are animal extracts or animal remains which enter into earth and are subjected to compression and compaction, and after a long time become fossil fuels like petrol and diesel. We have to understand that there is something called crude petrol. From that we will get petrol and diesel. We do not directly get petrol and diesel through crude petrol. Through processes we get petrol and diesel. So we know that energy is into two types: renewable energy and non-renewable energy. Renewable energy is which can be replenished any number of times and they are abundant in nature, which are not extinct: solar, wind, etc. Non-renewable energy, on the other hand, are after a span of time will get extinct, like fossil fuels. If they are used excessively, after a span of time petrol and diesel will become extinct. So there is an urgent need to look for renewable energy. When we know that renewable energy is so effective and efficient, then why are we using non-renewable energy? There are many reasons why we are using non-renewable energy. First, economical. It is not very costly to extract petrol and diesel. Second is, it is easily available, though not in our country, but if you see West Asia, like Saudi Arabia, Iran, Iraq, Kuwait, UAE, even US and Russia also have reserves. India also have little reserves, but it is not enough. So we go for imports from these countries. The third important is, if we see vehicles, they are fitted with petrol diesel engines. This is very easily acceptable. But if you come to solar, the vehicles should be fitted with panels. In some things, it is not economically viable also. And in some technologies like solar, we are still technologically not so ahead that we are able to make solar vehicles at a larger pace. So that is some of the reasons that why we are in non-renewable energy, and there is an urgent shift to renewable energy. So that is about fossil fuels. We'll see the impact in the next slide. We'll discuss the next things. Next is pollution. We understand that from fossil fuels, there is a huge chunk of different gases like carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, ozone, nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide, particulate matter 2.5, particulate matter 10, etc. These all, if we observe, come under air quality index. Please look into this, it is an important one. So, pollution comes from two sources again, point sources and non-point sources. Point is, see, for example, a factory. It is a point source. We know definitely that it is coming from so and so area and it is impacting this much of place. But non-point source, we cannot locate. We'll see the different types of pollution, how do they affect their environment, what is the impact, why is now Delhi becoming a gas chamber, why are India's cities named as one of the world's least ambient cities and most polluted cities. We'll look into this in detail. Next is greenhouse gas emissions. That is, as we have discussed, carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, ozone, etc. are greenhouse gas emissions. See, if we dwell into the history, from industrial revolution, which started in Britain, was the main source of transport. From there, we have went into fossil fuel transports on a slower pace. But after 2000, you could say, there was a huge jump in vehicles. And they used to pollute the environment in a higher amount. Our major source of energy comes from coal. We know that from trains to trolleys and in almost every industry we use coal, which is also a fossil fuel. The direct impact of it is humongous, but the indirect impact is causing the deaths of lot of children and infants. We'll also see how greenhouse gas emissions have changed our lives, and reduction of greenhouse gas emissions is the only solution to keep our earth a sustainable place to live. Next, impact on life systems. As we have discussed, it causes a lot of diseases like bronchitis, mental dysfunction, etc. Next, if you see, polar ice melting is happening because of fossil fuels. How is it related? We'll just see. First, when we burn, for example, latex, take carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is released into the atmosphere. The atmosphere absorbs carbon dioxide to a large extent and it shows symptoms of carbon emissions and enter into the life cycles of different elements, and they fall into the ice crystals of polar regions. As carbon dioxide is a hot air gas, the polar ice absorbs this carbon dioxide and stores in carbon and they melt. The impact of polar ice being melting is rise of sea level, first point. Second is the aquatic animal life of polar, like polar bears, etc., are losing their space. So when this much is happening, governments, intergovernments should have done something. Yes, they have tried their best, but still they have not achieved the desired goals. Some of them are Kyoto Protocol, Cartagena Protocol, summits like Copenhagen, etc. In these sessions, how to reduce greenhouse gases? How should we adopt a sustainable habitat? We also put some targets when to achieve this, but it is all about countries all coming into a legal framework and working towards sustainable development. As it is a voluntary framework, it is difficult for other countries to press upon other countries. So countries themselves should take responsibility in discussing and implementing environmental issues. Next, solution: renewable energy. Yes, let us see how it is. So let us see fossil fuel impact. First, we'll understand some terms and how fossil fuel impact in our day-to-day life. We'll see. First is biomagnification, that is, in these situations where toxins such as heavy metals like cadmium, etc., may pass through tropical levels exponentially more concentrated in the process. Let us deal in very simple terms. So let us see. First, see here, there is a small fish. It lives in aquatic life. Here it takes in toxins like cadmium, which are heavy metals, and this accumulate in this fish, and this is eaten by a bigger fish. And here the concentration of the toxins increase, and in the later stage this is eaten by some eagle. Here the accumulation of the toxins increases exponentially, whereby this creature is itself at risk. If you see here, small fish, here bigger fish, and here eagle. So the increase of toxins to the next level is called biomagnification. Next is ocean acidification. See, every water body has their own pH. For example, rivers have one pH, sea water has one pH, and ponds will have one pH. So when the carbon dioxide emissions increases, it causes concentration in the process, and pH of the water of the sea gets decreased, and that will turn into acidic. It impacts the aquatic life. Next, emissions of greenhouse gases. Simply to say, they lead to global warming. We know what is global warming. Increase of temperatures in the world because of greenhouse gases. Impact of it, we can say that short but heavy rains, forest fires, extreme disasters which are unwarranted, floods, droughts, whatnot. You have a lot of impact of the greenhouse gases. You will also be surprised to note that it reduces the amount of sunlight. Fossil fuels reduces the amount of sunlight. How? First, smog and haze. That is, in the morning if you wake up, there is, with pollution, the air gets mixed and they become smog and haze, which reduce the amount of sunlight which is received by plants to carry out photosynthesis. We know it, basics. And which leads to production of tropospheric ozone, which is dangerous to the plants. See, troposphere, stratosphere, so and so, exosphere. See, if the ozone is in stratosphere, it protects us directly from sunlight. But if the ozone is in the troposphere, it is dangerous to the plants and humans. Because we are not in the position to take ozone directly. It should become oxygen, or else we cannot take ozone. And it is in fact harmful when it is into the troposphere. And next, soil infertility. That is, if fossil fuels enter into the soil, they become infertile. See, if it becomes into aquatic, it becomes acidic. In the same way, if fossil fuels enter into soil, the soil also becomes acidic. It is not suitable for plants. The next is acid rain. We know sulfur dioxide and nitrogen dioxide can cause acid rain, which lowers the pH of the soil. If the pH of the soil reduces, it becomes acidic and it is unsuitable for plants. So we have seen in brief that how fossil fuel impact our day-to-day life. Now we will see pollution. Pollution is the next biggest cause of concern. What is pollution and what are the different types of pollution? We will see. But before that, what is pollution? Very simple. It is the introduction of contaminants into natural environment that cause adverse changes. Pollution can take forms of chemical and energy, noise, heat. We'll see the different forms. First is air pollution. Very simple. Release of chemicals and particulates into the atmosphere. Some common gaseous pollutions include carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, carbon fluorocarbons, nitrogen dioxide, which are produced by what? First is industry and second is motor vehicles. Photochemical smog and ozone are created by nitrogen dioxide and hydrocarbons react with sunlight. By this, air pollution is caused. Particulate matters like PM2.5, PM10, etc. are released, which directly enter into the lungs of the person and cause different types of diseases, which also include cancer. So next is electromagnetic pollution. Simple, overabundance of electromagnetic radiation in their non-ionizing form, like radio waves that people are constantly exposed to, causes electromagnetic pollution. Second is light is also a pollution. Over illumination and astronomical inferences also cause light pollution. Second is littering, that is, you throw inappropriate man-made objects into public and private places. That is littering. Next is noise pollution, you know, because of roadways, railways, aircrafts, etc. Plastic, this is one of the biggest pollution, and accumulation of microplastics, that is to say, which are less than 1 mm, is called microplastics. They are getting accumulated into oceans, and they are called ocean garbage, wherein they cannot dissolve into water, so they enter into the guts of fishes and into different aquatic animals and reduce the lifespan of them and others also who consume this. Next is radioactive contamination. Here nuclear power generators and nuclear weapons etc. create radioactive contamination. Next, thermal pollution, that is temperature change in natural water bodies because of human influence, such as, see, in a nuclear plant, for example, the coolant, that is the fuel which is being used, is released into water bodies like rivers, lakes, etc. So the temperature of this water, for example, is 7, it comes to 6 and 5. So the temperature change in water bodies is caused. We know that this kind of pH is not suitable for aquatic life. Next is visual pollution. It is because of overhead power lines, etc. Next, water pollution, we know. It is because of wastewater released from commercial and industrial waste into surface water, that is lakes and rivers. Next is soil pollution. This is related by spill or underground leakage. Contaminants could include hydrocarbons, heavy metals, herbicides, etc. So these are some of the forms of pollutions. So what are the issues with pollution? Health effects we'll discuss in the next slide. Environmental effects, we have discussed that pollution changes the status quo of the nature, that is, it will disrupt the normal cycles like oxygen cycle, carbon dioxide cycle, etc. Next, it affects the biodiversity. When the flora and fauna of a system gets disrupted, the whole ecosystem is at stake. And with pollution, even the sleep cycles of birds, the breeding seasons of them will change. Next, we have seen climate change, acid rains, floods, droughts, etc. This is a picture which shows the health effects of pollution. First, you can go through this picture, water pollution, air pollution, soil contamination, what kind of each component changes the system of the human. So, do we have strategies to control pollution? Yes. First is recycling, we all know. For example, plastic. It takes years, maybe thousands of years, for plastic to get degraded. So we can make roads out of plastic. In that way, you can recycle things. Reuse. We waste a lot of water. See, if we use the domestic water for gardening and other purposes, the water can be reused. Next is waste minimization. That is to say, plan individually and as a society depending on the waste generation. We can plan and minimize the waste. Next is mitigation. Mitigation is reducing the impact of anything. Example, mitigation of carbon dioxide or mitigation of fossil fuels. That is to reduce. Next is preventing. See, the Prime Minister has said we will prevent single-use plastic. See, this kind of clarions help us to develop a clear policy on plastic. And next is composting. We know vermicomposting, etc. So do we have pollution control devices? See, we are using automobiles, cars, vehicles, heavy and light. In this, we can fit some equipment wherein the combustion rate is reduced and the amount of pollution is also reduced. For example, in vehicles, you have this pipe which emits carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, etc. So generally what happens is they put a electrostatic precipitator which actually measures the amount of gases are released and it checks in as a filter and releases the very minimum amount of gases. So this kind of equipment is required, and that is the reason they say that within 6 months you will have to have that pollution check. These are the things which they check. Another example could be factories have something called chimney. You might have seen that the gases comes out. So when the process is going on, the gases are sent through a scrubber and electrostatic precipitator, wherein the gases are sedimented here only. Only normal steam and air goes out of this, and the sedimentation of poisonous toxin gases comes down. So in that way, thermal oxidizers and electrostatic precipitators are used. And in sewage treatment, that is a waste coming from domestic and industrial effluents, this can be treated by activated sludge biotreaters and constructed wetlands. In industrial wastewater treatments, we use biofilters and phytoremediation. So these are some of the pollution control devices to reduce or mitigate pollution. So from here we will concentrate on vehicles. See, we are using fossil fuel used vehicles. It will take time to get converted into electricity. We have different types of fuels like CNG, LPG, HCNG, etc. Though they emit comparatively less amount of pollution than fossil fuels, they are also not completely clean energies. They also need to have modifications. So, coming to electric vehicles, if they are produced with clean energies like solar, wind, tidal, etc., electric vehicles could make a mark and we could reduce the impact of pollution to large extent. So to keep fossil fuels in check, we have introduced some norms which are called Bharat Stage Emission Norms. That is to say that we will maintain some standards wherein we will not increase our pollutants like carbon monoxide, ozone, etc., which cause a very huge impact on health. So these emission standards were instituted by Government of India to regulate the output of air pollutants from internal combustion engines and spark ignition engine equipments, including motor vehicles. As we have discussed, motor vehicles release a lot of poisonous gases like carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, ozone, etc. So to reduce this amount, we have developed spark engine equipments which reduce the impact of air pollutants into the air. The standards and the timeline for implementation are set by CPCB, that is Central Pollution Control Board, which is under Ministry of Environment and Forest and Climate Change. So standards, though they are called Bharat standards, we have taken them from European standards, which was introduced in 2000. All new manufacturers after 2010 started BS3. You might have seen a lot of vehicles wherein the backside you will have BS3, BS4 norms. That is to say that they are compliant with the air pollutants, that is they are at minimum level and they are not causing much damage to the environment. This BS3 norms on vehicles quote that in 13 major cities, Bharat Stage 4 emission norms have been in place since 2010 and it has been enforced for entire country since April 2017. So BS4 came in 2010. It was started first in 13 major cities and later on it went into full by April 2017. Seeing the impact of pollution, we know that Delhi is a gas chamber. The Indian government felt that there is a need to skip BS5 and we'll go to BS6 directly, because the impact of fossil fuels is highest and the pollution is unbearable. So we thought we'll skip BS5 and we'll go to BS6. So we have to adopt BS6 norms by 2020. Even in the recent judgment, the Supreme Court has banned the sale and registration of motor vehicles conforming to the emission standard Bharat Stage 4 in the entire country from April 1st, 2020. So, use of alternative fuels has been promoted in India both for energy security and emission reduction. We can understand the importance of electric vehicles and also CNG, etc. For example, Delhi and Mumbai have more than 1 lakh commercial vehicles running on CNG fuel. Still, we are having the most pollutant tag for Delhi. That is because of there are lot of number of vehicles plying on the roads and the density in Delhi is highest. So we have tried different schemes like odd even policy, etc., but still it has not been streamlined. And if you see, Delhi has the largest number of CNG commercial vehicles running anywhere in the world. What matters in Bharat Stage norms? Fuel quality matters. That is, see, the petrol in one country is different from that of other country. That is, many chemicals may be added, the refinery process may be different. So to say, fuel quality plays an important role in meeting the stringent emission norms. The fuel specifications of petrol and diesel have been aligned with corresponding European fuel specifications for meeting of Euro 2, Euro 3 and Euro 4 emission norms. That is to say, from Euro 2, we have taken Bharat stage norms 2. So, as they are increasing to Euro 6, now we are also skipping to Bharat stage 6. Though independently, we are not completely taking their emission norms, but we have got inspired from them. For example, the BS4 grade fuel was introduced in 2010 and available in 39 cities as reported in 2016. The rest of the country has to do with BS3 fuel. We also have to understand that Bharat stage norms, if implemented, are costlier for both the manufacturer and the consumer. But it is the need of the hour, and moreover, if we go for cleaner fuels, the environment can be sustainable. Going the emission thing, Delhi and Mumbai have 1 lakh commercial vehicles, we have discussed. India is planning to introduce biodiesel ethanol petrol blends. That is to say, see, for example, a car is petrol fitted. It can have only petrol, and if some is diesel fitted, so only diesel. But now newer vehicles are fitted with CNG and petrol. That is, CNG can be used on one side and petrol can be used on the other side. Innovatively, we can also do biodiesel. That is to say that, for example, we use domestic waste that is taken by the industry and they make it as biodiesel, and you mix it this with petrol. For example, 90% petrol and 10% biodiesel. This is a sustainable way. This should have been in a phased manner and has drawn up a roadmap for the same. So the Indian auto industry is working with our authorities to facilitate for introduction of alternate fuels, which is the need of the hour. India has also set up a task force for preparing the hydrogen roadmap. Hydrogen is also a clean fuel. It is little costly when introduced, but on a span of time when people will be using on a large scale, this hydrogen quantity will increase and the price will get decreased. And use of LPG has also been introduced as an auto fuel, and the oil industry has drawn up plans for setting up auto LPG dispensing stations in major cities. You can see that we are shifting from petrol to diesel to CNG, LPG, and then next to HCNG, next to solar, wind, etc. See, here you can remember a fact: the share of fossil fuels in India is 79.8% as of 2019. In renewable energy, it is 17.3%. So we have to change from fossil fuels to renewable energy. And moreover, if you see, we have to import the major chunk from other countries. So to keep a balance on current account deficit, also we have to rely on renewable energy. So let us see how government is implying on electric vehicles, and we also should understand that fossil fuels shift is seen and there is a significant increase in electric vehicle plying. Government is committed in different protocols like Kyoto Protocol, Cartagena Protocol, that we will reduce our fossil fuels, we will reduce our carbon emissions. The government has come out with a National Electric Mobility Plan. It says national mission document providing the vision and roadmap for faster adoption of electric vehicles and their manufacturing in the country. See, we should understand that electric vehicles need a lot of equipment like chargers, stations, and the vehicles should be compliant with electricity, and also stations should be very close to the vehicles, and the electricity should be cheap. Then only people will opt for electric vehicles. And moreover, when the electricity is by coal, again you are creating a damage. Okay. For example, our electricity is coming from burning of coal. So even if you are using electric vehicles, the amount of coal is being burned in excess, and the electric vehicle is again coming to fossil fuel emissions only. That is to say, electricity should itself be clean. It should not come from coal. It should come from solar or hybrid or wind or tidal or geothermal, something like this. It should not come from again renewable energy like coal. Then the purpose will not be served. I hope the point is clear. We'll continue next. The plan has been designed to enhance national fuel security to provide affordable and environment friendly transportation and to enable the Indian automotive industry to achieve global manufacturing leadership. See, till now we did not have proper infrastructure for development of electric vehicles. Now we have to develop them first. And second, we have to see that the points of charging should be available. In India, it should be both environment friendly and economic friendly, or else people will not change to electric vehicles. Government is trying to incentivize electric vehicle manufacturers to come to India, or entrepreneurs are being asked to develop electric vehicles. If we observe, Tesla company, which is headed by Elon Reeve Musk, we can say that this person has pioneered electric vehicles. He is both an entrepreneur and an innovator. Take cue from people like them and take significant and tough decisions regarding electric vehicles. So, National Electric Mobility Mission Program 2020 is under Department of Heavy Industries, which is formulated a new scheme called FAME, that is Faster Adoption and Manufacturing of Hybrid and Electric Vehicles in India. This scheme is brought out to promote manufacturing of electric and hybrid vehicles and to ensure sustainable growth. The scheme has four focus areas. First is demand creation. Second is technology platform. Third, it should be used in pilot project. And fourth is charging infrastructure. That is to say simply that first, create demand for electric vehicles. Develop a technology platform for that. And try it in a pilot project first, that is on a smaller scale. But also look into the charging infrastructure, that is the car or vehicles should be charged. This is important. So the market creation through demand incentives was aimed at incentivizing all vehicle segments, 2, 3, and 4 wheelers, light commercial vehicles and buses also. That is to say that electric vehicles should be in all segments. See, we have given incentives to manufacturers. If you give incentive to customers also, then they will come to buy electric vehicles. So the demand incentive was available to buyers of electric and hybrid vehicles in the form of an upfront reduced purchase price to enable wider adoption. We can understand this. Also, grants was sanctioned for specific projects under pilot project, R&D technology, charging, etc. Generally, what government does is, for example, a new technology comes in, electric vehicles. They have to promote these electric vehicles. So they give incentives to both manufacturing and customer. So the manufacturer is interested to invest in electronic vehicles and customer will be interested in buying electronic vehicles. In that way, government promotes any new technology. In the first phase of FAME, which was started in 2015, we have seen about 2.78 lakh electric vehicles were supported with a total demand of 343 crores. You don't have to remember. Now, NEMMP 2020, there is an ambitious target to achieve 6 to 7 million sales of hybrid and electric vehicles by 2020. That is 70 lakh vehicles. So FAME has been from 4 years, from 2015 to 2019. So FAME 1 has been successful but had some issues. The first one was sufficient number of charging infrastructure is required to achieve expected outcomes. So they have took this as priority and they are trying to put that in phase 2 of FAME. Now we have been successful in FAME 1. So from 1st April 2019, FAME scheme 2 started. This is also by Department of Heavy Industries. An outlay of 10,000 crore for a period of 3 years will be given starting from 1st April. The main objective of the scheme is to encourage faster adoption of electric and hybrid vehicles by way of offering upfront incentive, as we have discussed, on purchase of electric vehicles and establishing necessary infrastructure for electric vehicles. Under the new GST design, the rates of GST on electric vehicles has been kept low in the bracket of 12% as against 28%, with cess up to 22% for conventional vehicles. Ministry of Power has also allowed this proposal. Generally, if we have to incentivize a new proposal, we have seen what happens. But we also should see, we have to disincentivize few others, like, for example, you are using petrol and diesel vehicles even when the electricity vehicles are viable and available, then petrol and diesel vehicles will be charged more. That is to say that SS may be put on petrol and diesel vehicles later, not now, because we are still in infant steps of electric vehicles. But when it gets into successful adventure, then later on, to disincentivize petrol and diesel, SS also may be put. So we have seen that the renewable energy could be a solution to the problems associated. Renewable energy is that which is collected from renewable resources which are naturally replenished on human time scale. We have discussed about fossil fuels. So renewable energy often provides energy in four important areas. First is electricity generation. Second is air and water heating cooling. Third is transportation. And fourth is rural off-grid energy services. The renewable energy provides energy in these four areas. So we have already seen renewable energy. What are the types? Solar energy, wind energy, tidal energy, geothermal energy, electricity, biofuels. We have taken a big initiative called International Solar Alliance, which is a party of 123 countries. We have pioneered this with France, and it's a successful model. It is between Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn countries. We have already built solar panels, and solar energy is going into the next level. This is one of the best renewable energies available. Next, if we see wind energy, our country, being a subcontinent, is well versed with different tropical and winds. So we are a wind abundant country. States like Gujarat, Andhra Pradesh, all coastal states can use wind energy for their consumption. The next is tidal energy. Even India has 7,000 plus area of sea, so you can use this tidal energy. And in places like Himachal Pradesh, there is a huge scope of geothermal energy, wherein through fissures of earth the energy comes out. We have to develop the technology. If so, geothermal energy can be harnessed. Hydroelectricity, you know, biofuels also, you know. So we have seen sustainable transport, electric vehicles, green vehicles, and plug-in hybrid vehicles are some of the types. So at last, why do we require electric vehicles? First, to restrict pollution, reduction of greenhouse gases, energy efficiency, energy resilience, and to restrict climate change, and at last sustainable development. Most importantly, we should have to focus on the charging infrastructure, because even if you are capable of making electric vehicles, charging infrastructures should be built in proximity to the consumer. What is charging infrastructure? Electric vehicle charging stations, also called electric vehicle charging station, electric recharging point, charging point, charge point, electronic charging stations, and electric vehicle supply equipment is an element in an infrastructure that supplies electric energy for recharging of plug-in electric vehicles, including electric cars, neighborhood electric vehicles, and plug-in hybrids. So at last, we can say we have to go back to nature. On this note, thank you very much.